morning, to be amongst co-professionals who are committed to the subject of child protection and child rights. It's really very enriching and fulfilling to be here to discuss these issues. So not in terms of having a pleasure to be here, but just a sense of commitment and concern that all of us are sharing here today. So when we begin, like she said, as contextualizing not only the seminar for child protection and empowerment of children, but seeing it in the larger context of what's happening in society today, we are using the peg point of what has happened recently in gender violence and violence against women and children, and to recognize that this is not one of a situation, but it's really a gender-based violence that is happening, which is reflection of the change in social fabric of our country. When we talk about violence, it's really, why does it happen is the analytical aspect to look at. So we sometimes, what happens is when we express outrage, we express condemnation, what really we are expressing at subsequent action of what has happened, which means we are responding not like a knee-jerk movement, because this movement is very, very active and has people here in the audience, I mean, as co-partners here today in this round table, who've made amazing contribution in the field of child sexual abuse, into kinds of women's issues, and working for rights-based framework within this, right? But at the same time, responses often occur subsequent to an action or an incident. Maybe today we need to relook at our commitment from a preventive approach, from ensuring that this doesn't happen. And it's like a paracetamol being given subsequent to fever, but not understanding why this fever is there. And there is a one-size-fits-all approach to situations, city-based or country-based. So first and foremost, for us to recognize that all of us are here to look at a holistic perspective, to look at a multidisciplinary approach, and to look at micro to macro level interventions. When we look at all of that, then we all ourselves are in a huge jigsaw where all of us fit within our spaces of making a difference. When we are making a difference, it really has to be from grassroots level to the macro level when it comes to programming, policy, and legislation. So unless we have this continuum, this is not going to work, because then it will be like a sporadic action, not a consolidated one. So that is one point of ensuring that it happens all through a systemic change and a multi-systems approach where an interdisciplinary professional team works at all of this. Within the interdisciplinary team, you have a whole lot of professions which will work together with all the allied systems that we are talking about, will be our response in relation to prevention and abuse. So if I begin by saying that we are in a state of change and challenge, and we need systemic changes. Why is this happening in our country in terms of vulnerability as being seen as something to target, whether it's vulnerability based on age, gender, sex, whether it's based on caste, class, creed, community? Wherever there is vulnerability, it's a understanding the social context of power and control. This power and control comes more evident when it's in the context of children and women, especially children who are the most vulnerable, voiceless section of society. So this is understanding the social fabric of our country. The key issues in the context of children and women. First, in the context of children, are we look at neglect, abuse, violence, and exploitation. These are the four areas of intervention in terms of prevention, rehabilitation, and reconstruction of lives. We look at neglect, abuse, violence, and exploitation. If these four become our key points to remember, we can look at strategy for action in all of this. The second issue is about gender-based violence. Why is there gender-based violence in terms of women and girl child? And then this is an analytical framework that we need to understand why this happens. The third thing we need to look at is also the analysis and focus on the psychology of crime as to why is this criminal activities, are they increasing? Are they coming more to light? Are they being reported or are they being whatever? So what is changing in all of this is our perception, our cognition, our attitude towards this whole situation of violence against individuals and people. The values that we are focusing on often is about competition and not collaboration and compassion. Everywhere in this world, people are now operating out a sense of inadequacy, sense of frustration, sense of anger. And where does all of this lead is outward. The way to you know, handle frustrations and anger and all in our life, right from the child. If a child falls down, what do you tell a child? Oh, hit the floor and say, "Arre, bachche ko mara." It's not the floor that has hit the child. The child has fallen down and it's an activity. From the beginning, as small as an activity, why bachche ko mara? Now, what are you telling the child? That the way to cope with anything that happens is outside of oneself. So this outside of oneself for looking at causative factors, looking at reconstruction factors, looking at everything is outside of oneself. The development of self in terms of coping mechanisms, in terms of coping with stress, anxiety, frustrations, in a competitive way, where the values of compassion, collaboration, and cooperation are way down, and the values of competitiveness and one-upmanship have received value. A lot of study we did on perpetrators of crime, the ones who have done, you know, gang rapes, or they have done rape, like one of the main cases that I analyzed was the train victim, Borivali train case. It was like 10 years ago, but it was one of the first cases there. To understand what is the trauma of the child is one thing, but look, also we looked at why this person got into it. Where are we looking at understanding the, see, the forensic psychiatrists and all will come into our team at a later stage to understand and to diagnose and whatever that's happened. For us to understand the criminology of action and of why it has happened, and to decriminalize children's activities, but also to bring into focus the adult activities, was to understand what trauma this person had gone. Not to justify it, not to say that it has happened, but to understand and explain a situation. A single child brought up with amazing amount of violence and the kind of beating up that he had gone through. So much trauma, no education, dropout from school, alcoholic father, and a community which was extremely negative. So all this explained to where his violence was coming from. And then to understand that this perpetrator needs as much rehabilitation as the child. This is once again not to underpin the thing of the child, but also to understand the entire fabric of our social culture, which is changing. The interventions are sometimes required at three levels, in terms of prior to the crime happening, in terms of advocacy and awareness, at the time when it is actually happening, in terms of emotional support and psychological counseling, subsequent to the crime, in terms of forensic experts, you know, seeing the case to a logical conclusion and ensuring that the case has, you know, the justice is done to the child or to the women, and seeing it to a logical, to a fast track court. So these will be our recommendations when it happens. But the intervention strategies have to be at three levels of prevention, which is prior to crime happening, subsequent to crime happening while it is going, so the trauma and post-trauma stress disorders that the person is likely to go through, how do we develop intervention strategies for that, and finally to see from the legal expert's point of view, and you know, we have all our colleagues who are here, how they take this case forward and take it to see that the perpetrator of the crime has a conviction that happens. So the conviction rate in our country being the low way it is, the fast track courts not being available, the justice delayed is justice denied. So these are some of the things there. The focus on the why and analysis will help us to develop our strategies for intervention. Now, the programs, policies, and legislations from micro to macro level need a convergence. What tends to happen is all of us have platforms like this to interact, but somewhere we reinvent the wheel each time. So what we probably need to do today is form a kind of an action group or a way forward where there is dovetailing, where there is convergence, where there is partnership, and where there is consolidation of everybody's efforts with understanding that each one will do this in their own areas of reference, but we will not learn, like, develop new material. We don't need to develop more and more things, but we need to share. So sharing becomes the key aspect of our work together today on terms of consolidation and networking and dovetailing. This multi-systems approach is about sharing responsibility and responses. You know, this is some of the things that we've always worked with as a multidisciplinary team with KM Hospital, with Nair Hospital, with Sion Hospital, where some of us who are with the Child Welfare Committee or some of us who are actually seeing the cases at the grassroots level and who have helped, who are able to contribute at policy level with the Juvenile Justice Act, with the Child Protection, the Child Sexual Abuse Prevention Act, all of these convergence of laws. Also, once again, we need to ensure that there is no inherent contradiction. There is harmonization with the UNCRC on Convention on Rights of Children, recognizing the age of the child and consent and all of these factors. So that aspect also as a multidisciplinary team is important. So if I talk at the end in terms of what are some of the challenges before us, I think one of the things is the victimization of the victim that happens is our key concern. That, you know, the kind of trauma they've gone through, then the kind of awareness, I mean, the media, whatever. Media is doing an amazing job of bringing this into awareness. But the kind of sensitivity, not objectifying what has happened, but focus not on the person alone, but more on the issue that has happened, recognizing the need for confidentiality as well as the privacy of the person who's gone through, because otherwise you're victimizing the victim further. The second concern for us is this breaking the culture of silence. This breaking the culture of silence in the context of sexuality, sexual deviancies, in sexual harassment, in sexual, there is a whole definition under the new act of 6 different types of sexual, what you call it as a sexual. So penetration is no more just the way to talk about rape, but it has all kinds of levels of violence against a child. So having recognized all of that, we need to empower children to say, how do we break the silence? On one hand, we have this whole thing about mandatory reporting. On the other hand, you have the concern for confidentiality and privacy of the child. So somewhere, I'm sure Vidya has done a lot of, I'm sure has you this thing about us, how do you balance this whole thing about mandatory reporting versus respecting the confidentiality, privacy of the child or the woman for whom this has happened.